And I now invite Dr. Ishwar Gilada, a globally acclaimed HIV expert. And Dr. Gilada was the first doctor to raise the alarm against AIDS in India in 1985. He's also president of AIDS Society of India, and he's also going to share some very important news in the lead up to WAF. Over to you, Dr. Gilada.
Thank you very much, Shobhaji, for this introduction. In the galaxy of speakers and experts, I'm not claiming to be a very big expert in the infectious diseases. I'm basically no voice, but I realize that everybody of us should contribute in whatever way we can. While I'm sharing the presentation, okay. Can you see?
Yes.
Okay. So basically, I belong to four different organizations. Unison is my clinic, AIDS Society of India, of which I'm a president, International AIDS Society, of which I'm a governing council member, and Organized Medicine Academic Guild. This is a conglomerate of 15 different professional organizations, which are professional organizations in the field of postgraduate medicine. So we represent almost 250,000 doctors in the country. When we look at why it is important, because we have limited antibiotics, we don't have n number of antibiotics. Still limited, more than that, we have limited antivirals. No one has seriousness, no preserving antimicrobial or antimicrobial stewardship is there. Who should be blamed and who should take a call? That is also an issue. Stigma associated with the place of origin, like sometime Indian superbug in London found. So because of that issue, nobody wants to talk about it. And if you look at the graph of last 100 years, we have last 30 years, not any new antibiotic class has come, though we have carbapenem, but in the existing class. So new class of antibiotics are not there. So we have limitation over there. And look at all the issues. Every time there is a newspaper heading, MDR-TB, MDR-HIV, a lot of other drug resistance is coming. But we do not see a war footing moment to stop it. Infectious diseases, they are the leading cause of death in India. India is the world's largest consumer of antibiotics. Now, when we say largest or second or third, India being second in population will be second, third or fourth in many problems, many diseases, many crimes, and also making of any products like antibiotics. More than 60% antibiotics prescribed in adult, and they are not required. So indiscriminate use is there. A study in Tamil Nadu shows that 60% of the children were resistant to at least one antibiotic. So when children get resistance, that means you can imagine how much they have been already treated. Out of the 2 lakh infections related to neonatal deaths, 30% attributed to MRSA and ESBL. And 15% of those undergoing TB treatment have MDR-TB. Now you look at, this is a basically PPP, the practice policy pharma dependent issue, also sometimes patient dependent issue. So either triple P or 4P, India the only country with OTC. Now you go anywhere in the world, even smallest of the countries, you cannot buy antibiotics, you cannot buy steroid, you cannot buy anything on OTC, but India you can buy anything. Not only that, rather than strip, they can give you 2 tablets, 4 tablets also. Lot of quackery and fakery. So sometimes we have a lot of quacks, we do not know their degrees. There's one doctor whose degree was MRSH, it's called, what do you call it? CTBH. I asked him, what is CTBH? He said, compounder for 3 years in Bombay Hospital. So they make any kind of degrees like that. Also indiscriminate use by qualified doctors. Antibiotic stewardship is absent. Poor patient awareness. Patient do not know. Sometimes they come and demand why you are not giving antibiotic and doctors budge in. So if the patient would ask that I would like to die, can you provide me poison? Doctors don't give. But when a patient requests for an antibiotic or antiviral, doctors give. Adult immunization, very poor concept. Only in COVID people realize that adult immunization is there, is existing. Though we have at least 10, 15 different adult vaccines not been used. Audits and surveys are very poor. Engaging policymakers, planners, administrators, pharma and healthcare workers, and it is done minimally as a tokenism. In COVID, what we have seen is an increase of an unnecessary hospital stays. So as soon as the oxygen concentration come down to 93, 94, people got admitted. Once people got admitted, they got pressurized that there is only one or two bed available in ICU. Would you like to be shifted to ICU? They were shifted to ICU. And similarly, every stage, they were overtreated and unnecessary admissions. OTC and media-driven use of antimicrobial, even giving source of Ministry of Health. I'll show you this slide. Stockpiling and self-medication. As soon as headlines came, azithromycin works or doxycycline works, people stockpiled and they started using on their own as soon as they started one single symptom of COVID or COVID-related symptom. Indiscriminately used by doctors. So I don't want to spare doctors. They have also done the same thing. And we have seen Candida auris, which is a fatal condition, which is a gift of COVID, just like mucormycosis. So you see this slide. Though it is dated 03 June 2021, even today you open any kind of DTS, direct-to-home television channels, for example, Hathway, and starting all these slides come. And it says, when do you use steroid? When do you use antibiotic? When do you get hospitalized? So if you are educating directly to the home, the persons are going to go to doctors. They are going to go to, and doctors also want to encash that kind of situation. So this kind of thing should stop. Despite writing to the top level in the country, it has not been stopped. I've been writing since June. Now you look at this prescription, a typical prescription of a COVID positive person, nothing else but a COVID RT-PCR positive. 10 different medicines, 3 different antibiotics, 2 different antivirals, and they were all given together. So basically, there are some solutions. There can be some solutions. So inculcate a culture of organisms. So we don't have a culture. We just have a syndromic way of management, and that should stop. Antibiogram, what ICMR has developed. So that should be more popularized. Involve microbiologists in hospital infection control practices. We have N number of qualified MD microbiologists, but they are not involved in hospital infection practices. Only in big cities, they have an importance of that. In other smaller places, there is no importance. And what I would like you to take home is antimicrobial resistance is yet another pandemic, and it will explode any day. It will be which will have much bigger proportion than COVID. It is man-made, medical profession driven, pharma-sponsored, and officially or policy neglected calamity. We need collective steps with the sense of urgency, and we should stop the indiscriminate use of antibiotics like peanuts. You take 4 days or 2 days, or if you feel better, you stop. The COVID-19 pandemic has provided us an opportunity to relook how abundantly and irresponsibly antibiotic as well as antivirals were used. Let us derive our lessons from these experiences of COVID pandemic and contain it before it is too late. So basically, we do not learn from experience. We learn from reflecting on the experience. And I think this meeting is also going to be a learning experience for me to some extent. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gilada. And now we will take up, if there are any questions for Dr. Walia and Dr. Gilada. There is a question for Dr. Walia. Yes, Dr. Walia, there is a question that should drug sensitivity profiling of patients be done routinely in hospitals? And I'm sure Dr. Gilada can respond to that question too. It is not happening, but is it important?
No, it can't be done as a routine procedure. How many bugs you will routinely profile a patient for? It has to be targeted to a clinical syndrome that the patient is having, because all your pathogens depend on what kind of pathogen you are looking for will depend on whether the patient has a UTI or a patient has what kind of routine profiling is he referring, the person who's asking the question referring to. I'm not sure, but it can't be done like this. If you are looking for example, carbapenem resistant organisms, then you have to look for a carriage, because you don't want the patient who's admitted and carrying carbapenem resistant bugs to spread that in the hospital. That can cause outbreaks. So those are kind of things that you have to isolate the patient. So those are the things in where you undertake this kind of screening, but not otherwise.
Okay. There is a question for Dr. Gilada from Pakistan. Wali Haider wants to know that there's a use of a range of medicines from different disciplines in Pakistan also for COVID. They had non-medical studies, yes. But and Dr. Gilada, is HIV drug resistance a problem on decline or is it escalating?
HIV drug resistance problem is on declining because currently we are using dolutegravir based regimen, which resistance profile of dolutegravir is very good. Number one. Number two, NACO, National AIDS Control Organization, has been proactively very active in proper use of ART. And since 2004, they launched a free ART program. Almost 90% of the people are treated at ART centers and only 10% are in private sector. So currently, if you look at different kind of resistance, it is between 3 to 5%. But because of the dolutegravir and there is another drug called darunavir, they have a very good resistance profile, and therefore we can always switch on them without doing a resistance profile of any person, because that is more expensive than the drug for a couple of months' time.
Okay. Thank you very much. And now I would invite Thomas for his comments on this as well.
No, I would just like to thank Dr. Walia and Dr. Gilada for their excellent remarks, and I thought I learned a lot, having originally, I come from India originally, although I'm now in Geneva, but it's really interesting to see what's happening and the progress that's being made and the challenges that are specific to that. But most of all, Shobha, I want to thank you and thank Bobby at CNS for arranging this. I thought it was really informative, very useful. And I want to invite all the journalists who, if they wish to be part of the AMR newsletters that WHO issues, if you could write and tell Bobby that we can't forcibly put you, you have to, volunteer to receive our newsletters. So if you can indicate that you want to receive our newsletters, you will get them, including the one that's coming out tomorrow with all the events about WOW and then every day after that. And then after that, we don't send very often, but it's useful if you would like to do that. So thank you all very much.
Thank you very much. And in fact, there have been some requests to have this forum when possible for everyone at convenient time. This is from Papua New Guinea, from the Pacific side, and also from Pakistan, that a regular forum for will be good. Usually we go to meet and report, but learning is left behind in the hurry. So maybe we can have some sort of information exchange and knowledge sharing platform. So we can respond to this call after this year's WAP, when we all go blue, and perhaps a media platform on AMR for knowledge sharing amongst ourselves, as well as from WHO experts and other country experts, could perhaps further our understanding on AMR and how it impacts our lives. So this is just a suggestion which has come from a few people, and I think with the help from stalwarts like you all who were present here today as speakers, we may give it a push. So with this, we come to the close of today's session. And I'm sure today's Global Media Forum has sensitized each one of us around AMR and energized us enough to join forces and help create awareness through our work. My sincere thanks to all the speakers for enriching today's session with their invaluable reflections. And of course, to the participants for their very, very active participation. Special thanks to Mr. Thomas Joseph and Dr. Leanne Gonzalez for helping us make the event possible. Stay safe, stay healthy, and goodbye till we meet again.